آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا ثم أما بعد. I hope you guys miss those sessions from Riyadh-us-Saliheen as much as I did. Baraka of Hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the life of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum. If you still remember, the last thing we discussed before we took a break was the Kitab al-Du'awat, the book of a du'a, the supplications. And we learned about the etiquettes and the akhlaq and the manners and what kind of du'a, you know, to be mentioned and so on. Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, interestingly, right under the chapter, under the book of a du'a, under the book of the virtue of supplication and du'a, he mentions a specific chapter. قَالَ بَابُ كَرَامَاتِ الْأَوْلِيَاءِ وَفَضْلِهِمْ. Says this is a chapter on the superiority and the virtue of al-awliya and their marvels, like the karamat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts under their hands. What does that exactly mean? What is the meaning of awliya? Who are they? And what's so special about them and unique about them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قال أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة لا تبديل لكلمات الله ذلك هو الفوز العظيم. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the awliya, again we mentioned the word awliya, we're going to define it inshallah ta'ala right now. But he says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. No doubt, verily the awliya of Allah, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Which means they shall have absolutely no fear. لا خوفٌ عليهم. They should have no fear for themselves. ولاهم يحزنون. And they should have no grief or sorrow. What does that mean? No fear from the future, what they're going to face in the future. ولا يحزنون. And no grief or sorrow for anything that's in the past. So their past, Allah will reconcile that for them. And the future will be secured for them. Who are they? Allah defined them subhanahu wa ta'ala with two qualities. قال الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. Those who have faith and those who have taqwa. May Allah make us among them, ya Rabbil Alameen. Two things. Does this sound difficult, Jama'ah? Wallahi, that is the beauty of the mercy and the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not difficult to enter His wilaya. To be one of the awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal is not difficult in general. But in terms of practice, there's a lot of jihad fi sabilillah there. You can be a faithful person. You can be mu'min. But how many of us can reach that level of taqwa, that level of righteousness and piety? They're conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is almost constant. But those are the true awliya of Allah azza wa jal. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, he says, when it comes to the awliya, he's taken from the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the category of the believers. What did he say? قال فمنهم ظالم لنفسه ومنهم مقتصد ومنهم سابق بالخيرات. Three categories he said. Some of them are ظالم لنفسه. What does that mean, ظالم لنفسه? The one who transgressed against themselves. So the believers are one of three. One is ظالم لنفسه. They transgress among themselves. What does that mean? They believe, but they have so much baggage. Like they have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they make a lot of mistakes, a lot of sins. They're still believers, but their iman is so weak that they allow themselves to make a lot of mistakes and a lot of errors. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them, ya Rabbil Alameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from falling into this category. So that is the ظَالِمُ لِنَفْسِهِ. They believe, they have faith, but they still make a lot of mistakes. قَالْ وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدْ. The second category is مُقْتَصِدْ. What does that exactly mean? Someone who is kind of like moderate. They do good things, alhamdulillah, but not as great as they should be. What does that mean? Maintain the five daily prayers. They fast Ramadan, alhamdulillah. They give their zakah. They care about their hajj and ibadah and ta'ah and so on. But when it comes to praying the sunnah or nafil, not my thing. Praying tahajjud, fasting Mondays and Thursdays, Ramadan is enough for me. This person is muqtasid. So they don't really fall short on fulfilling their obligations. And they don't fall into the major sins, probably. But they have also some errors and some mistakes. And this is also part of the believers, obviously, and awliya. Then he goes, قَالْ وَسَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ. Those are the one who's the foremost. the one that always strive and struggle to be at the top. They're not just satisfied with the fard salah. They come early to the jama'ah. They pray in the masjid. Their salah is in jama'ah congregation. They add the nafil and the sunnah. When it comes to fasting, Ramadan is not sufficient for them, not enough. I want to add more, Mondays and Thursdays. So they do a lot. Like they create a lot of buffer. And he says that one of their biggest ibadah, one of their biggest ibadah is what? قال عبادات القلوب, the heart. What they worship, you know, with their heart. Because they might say things, they might recite. You know, a lot of people, mashallah, they might be coming to the masjid even. They pray, and they pray regularly. But Allah musta'an, they might, astaghfirullah, end up in Jahannam. Why? Because their qalb is not there, so the quality of the ibadah doesn't count. A lot of things might affect the quality of their ibadah. He says, ibadatul qalb, their heart is always attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the people whom are considered sabiqoon, the awliya of Allah, the top of the awliya. And then he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, obviously the highest rank of awliya. Can you guys guess who that would be? The highest rank of the awliya, who are they? The anbiya, the prophets. The prophet and the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we cannot make dua and say, ya Allah, make us a prophet or a messenger, right? It's over. But you can still ask Allah to make one of the awliya as-saliheen. So Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he says, qala wa ala qadri at-ta'a. So as close as you come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of your iman and taqwa, this is how much wilaya you get with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so what does it mean then to be wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The English translations has a very poor, you know, definition of wilaya. So they use the words friends of Allah azza wa jal, protectors, guardians, custodians, they use a lot of different words for it. Nothing defines the meaning of being wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The wali of Allah azza wa jal is not just a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but an ally, a friend, an ally, you know, the closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means to be wali of Allah azza wa jal. And for being a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some people might say, well, that means I'm out. I can't be wali of Allah azza wa jal. I don't have a degree in Islamic studies. I didn't go to Medina. You know, I barely can do this, I can do that. You don't have to be a scholar to be a wali. You don't have to. As a matter of fact, the Prophet mentioned the hadith that among the three categories of people with whom Jahannam will be first fueled, he says, qala alim, someone who's a scholar. Wow. Scholars end up in Jahannam as a fuel for Jahannam. Yeah. Because he said, the Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says, qala, because this person, he sought knowledge for what? Liyuqala alim. Looking for the fame and the name. And the Prophet says, waqad qeel. He got it. When people used to see him or hear his name, oh, mashallah, Sheikh Fulan, alim Fulan. He got it, but he got it for the dunya, Allah musta'an. So you don't have to be a alim or a scholar or this or that to become a wali of Allah Azza wa Jal. You can be a peasant. A peasant. Someone in the desert. But these people, they have so much iman, so much taqwa and piety in their hearts, that when they raise their hand, Allah will answer their call. Those are awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that's why even some of the ulama, they would say, when they die, they say, I hope that I would die ala imani ajaiz naysabur. Like my iman would be as strong as the iman of the old women of Nisabur, one of the cities, you know, from the past. Why? Because he said, these are simple ladies, but their iman is so strong, they have no doubt in it, it makes them like being awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means, can a woman be awliya of Allah azza wa jalla jama'a? Absolutely. Al-wilaya to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a matter of faith. It's not a matter of gender, matter of age, or how much knowledge you have. It's how much iman and how much piety and taqwa you will have. So that's something opened for everybody. What do you get if you become a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can you guys guess? Allahu Akbar. Absolute protection. And the Prophet says in the hadith, he said, man aada li waliyan faqad aadantuhu bil harb. If you dare, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith Qudusi, that Allah is saying, if anyone dares to show any hostility or enmity to one of my awliya, I'll stand against them in war. Can you imagine standing against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What kind of weapons are you going to carry? Whatever you do. He says, فَقَدْ أَذَنْتُهُ بِالْمُحَارَبَةِ. I will fight against him. I'll defend my awliya. And Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala in this hadith Qudsi that Allah Azza will become the light of your heart, of your eyes, of your hand, of your actions, whatever you do, you'll have guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why in the ulama they define al-awliya in translation that divinely inspired people. Like when they do things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspire them to do these khairat and this goodness. But obviously, they've been inspired because of what? Because of the how much effort they put in it in the first place. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who struggle and strive in our paths, we shall guide them to us. Then Imam Ibn Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned a few ayat as well to give us examples of awliya. The first example, which is very interesting and very ironic, he brings example of whom? Can you guys guess what example he will bring to the awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal? It's a person, but who's that person? Huh? Musa alayhi salam? No. No. Maryam. A lady. قال وهزي إليك بجدع النخلة تساقط عليك رطبا جنيا. You just shake that tree with your hands, we'll make the tree, we'll make the palm tree fall all this beautiful, tasty and sweet fruit to come upon you. And why is that? Because of her status. Allah selected her subhanahu wa ta'ala for a very special status. So what happens to Maryam is considered karama. So when these kind of miracles happen to the prophets, we call them mu'jizat, mu'jiza. When they happen to non-prophet, we call them karama in the Arabic language, like an honorable recognition from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. So it came in the form of shaking that tree, and even though it's a palm tree, how can you shake a palm tree? But for a lady just gave birth, Allah subhanahu made it easy for her and soft. Also, قال كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب وجد عندها رزقا. Every time Zakaria, who was her guardian, enters the mihrab, her chamber, he finds fresh fruit, out of season. Alhamdulillah, for us, we can't even comprehend that because tabarakallah, you go to the grocery store, you don't just have fruits out of season. You have fruits out of even the geographical location that you live in. It's like a Jannah style, a jama'ah over here. So there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَ الْمِحْرَابِ وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا. He finds rizq there, provision that is not usually be in the, from that area. قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمُ أَنَّ لَكِ هَذَا. Where is this coming from? قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. It's from Allah. He provides whomever he wills without any hisab, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he mentioned another example of the awliya. Who were they? The people of the cave. أهل الكهف. قال وإذا اعتزلتموهم ما يعبدون من دون الله أو ما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف. Says when you leave your people and you go to the cave, Allah will take care of you over there. And he made them subhanahu wa ta'ala as a miracle for us, and that was karama for these people. So Maryam is a lady, and these young people, in terms of who they were, in terms of for us, random people. Average people, they just believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah made them into awliya. You want to be wali? Bismillah. You have the chance. So you have to have faith, and you have strong iman and taqwa. Finally, would these awliya have some sort of like a superpower that people can go to them to get that help from them? Like some people think when you have awliya, they will have superpowers. Like they can fly, they walk over the water, they, mashallah, do things, they walk on the fire and the charcoal and all these kind of things and so on. Here's the thing, awliya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they hide this wilaya. They don't go about it to go out and take videos and pictures and brag about and have their followers, you know, worship them almost, astaghfirullah. That doesn't happen. And also when they die, that's it. They can't help you anymore. They can do nothing for you. So people to go to some shrines of ulama and scholars and noble people and ask them for favors and so on, astaghfirullah. What about Allah Azza wa Jal? So therefore, al-awliya, this is something unique for them, not for you and I, to go and ask them for things that you can only ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's also for us a reminder. Ibn Abbas and Ibn Mas'ud, when they were asked about defining al-awliya, what did they say? It says, al-awliya qawmun idha ra'ahumun nas dhakarullah. Just to simply define who awliya are, somebody, when you see them, and if you see that person, you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like when you see the, when you see them coming in, you say, mashallah, mashallah, tabarakallah, subhanallah. That's what you mention when you see these people. Because I know other people, when you see them, what do you say? Nastaghfirullah, say, a'udhu billah, right? Or say, alhamdulillah. But no, these people, when you see them, you just remember Allah Azza wa Jal, because they truly, just their sight is enough to remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of these people was Imam ibn Sirin, rahimahullah ta'ala, Muhammad ibn Sirin. They said about him, whenever they went, he enters the marketplace, people just start making dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. Just seeing him, he reminds them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like as if everybody wants, wish that you can be like them in terms of their ibadah and their ta'am. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among the awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal. Wallahu a'lam. Any question, Jama'ah? Yes. I'm sorry, I can barely hear you. So are you saying, so the question is, the example that were mentioned here, Maryam and the people of the cave, they got that level of wilaya because of their isolation, right? Which means khalwa. They kind of like dedicated their time to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why they got that, right? That might be correct or accurate about Maryam, but not necessarily about the people of the cave. The people of the cave were actually the opposite. They wanted to worship, they wanted to stay with their people, but when they become so threatening for them, they ran away, going to another place where they can be with other people who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah chose them when they went to the cave, when they slept, to sleep these 100 years. So it's not just about isolating yourself. As a matter of fact, the Prophet ﷺ says, "الذي يخالط الناس ويصبر على أذاهم خير من الذي لا يخالط الناس ولا يصبر على أذاهم." The one who intermingles with the people and show patience in regards to dealing with them, better than the one who disassociate from the people and not try to bear, you know, the hardship of dealing with them. Wallahu a'lam. Now, yes.
Do people know when they become awliya of Allah? How do they know?
Very good point. Do people know that they become awliya of Allah Azza wa Jal? Like if there is a meter that you see very close, alhamdulillah. And then, obviously, if you're focused on becoming wali of Allah Azza wa Jal, you're going to go far away from it. You don't try to focus on becoming wali because Allah selects his awliya. Your job is just to be obedient, have faith, and taqwa. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will elevate your status among the people. Allah is the one who chooses, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the thing, when Allah chooses a person like that, he chooses them because their iman have reached that level that they hide it. They hide it from the people. The true awliya of Allah, they try to run away from the people in that sense. Because they want to hide their, if there was any specific status for them, they're not going to brag about it. They just want to appreciate that between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam. Now. Yes?
What about going to people or Rasulullah to ask them to make
dua? I mean, going to people to ask them to make dua is okay. You can do that. Sahaba used to do that sometimes, and it's fine. However, there's no dua better than the one that comes from your heart. That's the most powerful one. Wallahu a'lam. Na'am. Khair inshallah ta'ala. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.